All right, YouTube, it's time to talk about the rise of the third party within American politics. Politics again, but at least it's on something other than Trump and Cruz flinging insults at one another's wives, or how Hillary Clinton had a vagina 30 years ago. That's all you'll hear on, like, Gawker Media until it's finally destroyed, by the way. That or how Bernie Sanders' socialism is totally different from all the other forms of socialism. Don't worry, folks. Your wallet will be fine. In the description is a link, and it shows apparently Gary Johnson in a hypothetical matchup involving the presumable nominees of the Republican and Democratic parties. I can't imagine that Ted Cruz is going to be able to mount an effective defense against Trump at this point. I can't imagine Sanders, whether he's tied nationally or not, can make up the sort of deficit that he has with Hillary Clinton. I think it's virtually unthinkable. I mean, you'd have to have... What is it like? Ted Cruz would need to win 85% of the remaining delegates. Is that going to happen? No. Sanders would need to win, I think it's like 90%. Also, probably not going to happen unless Hillary has a massive stroke on stage. In such a hypothetical matchup, Gary Johnson, who's the presumable Libertarian nominee, he's far ahead of anybody else. You know, other than McAfee, I hadn't even heard of anybody else, honestly, within the Libertarian platform. Manages to get double-digit totals. Now, 10 to 15% of the vote may not sound like a lot, but that would be the strongest showing for a third party in a hell of a long time. You're looking back basically at the Teddy Roosevelt era when he ran against Taft, and I can't remember who else was in the race, who the Democrat was. When Teddy Roosevelt, of course, got jilted by his own party when he wanted to take... He put Taft into power. He got elected as a progressive Republican. Things were going good. He put Taft in there after a term, said, I'm going to go fucking explore the Amazon and all this other shit. Taft sort of mishandled things other than the trust busting, and so Teddy came back and said, well, I want to get back in here because Taft's a screw-up. They wouldn't let him. So he formed his own, the Bull Moose Party, the third party, and ran against Taft, ran him down so badly, not only did he come in third place to the Democratic and this new third party headed by Teddy Roosevelt, but broke down in literal tears several times in the campaign trail because this was his former friend calling him basically a lard ass. He was sort of the Chris Christie of his era. But it's time to talk about specifically why the Libertarian Party would suddenly have gained a fairly large degree of dominance compared to its former showings. One of the reasons is Ron Paul. Most Americans, until 2012, when Ron Paul became meme-worthy, didn't even fucking know that there was any party other than Republican and Democrat. If they knew what libertarianism was at all, they didn't really think much about it. It hadn't quite sunk in yet that the problem went beyond one specific party. Most people were still partisans at the time. What has happened since then, partially because of how Ron Paul was treated by the GOP, partially because of some of the rise of the internet and social media in general anyway, is more and more disenfranchised Democrats and Republicans have become nonpartisan. They become independent voters. A lot of those people really like libertarianism because libertarianism appeals to Democrats that have strong views on social issues but don't really have strong views on fiscal issues, because the Democrats, they're fiscally authoritarian. They're socially a little bit closer to libertarians. Libertarians out-liberal the liberals on social issues. It appeals especially to the younger demographics. They out-conservative the conservatives on fiscal views. So if a person is strongly fiscally conservative and doesn't really care so much about evangelism or Zionism or one of these things that, you know, you would think of the Bush Republicans or the Romney Republicans or certainly the fucking Cruz Republicans caring about, they tend to have a more positive view of libertarianism. Now, as a libertarian that has a fairly large online presence, you know, talks not just on YouTube, I troll people constantly on Facebook. I troll the left wing, I troll the right wing, you know, many times a day. And the uniting feature is this: neither of them, when they criticize you and what you're saying, they don't actually know what they're criticizing. What they think libertarianism is not actually libertarianism. The right looks at it and thinks, well, you're basically just a Democrat who happens to be more anarchist-leaning You know, you're severe. You don't want Jesus in government, so you're a fucking hippie. You want free drugs for everyone and open borders and all these horrible things. You're just a miscreant far leftist. They think you're basically a pinko. I've been called a communist before by right wingers for being a libertarian. If you talk to the Democrats about libertarianism, or say something libertarian to them, they'll say, oh, you're just a Republican who wants to smoke weed. You know, you're far, far to the right, but you're also probably a drug user or something like that. You know, you're a Republican in every way except on the drug war or except on in the police state or something like that. If you end up, though, talking to Democrats primarily about social issues, you're going to get along with them. They'll think that you're maybe a little bit too far left. If you just talk about gay marriage and equality for women and all of these things, they'll think you're a little bit kooky. If you talk to the Republicans about just fiscal issues, they'll think you're one of them. They might think that you're, you know, beyond the Tea Party. They may think you're to the right of Sarah Palin, you know, total fringe loony, but they'll accept you generally. They'll say, well, you're a little bit of a whack job, but I guess it's better than what fucking Hillary Clinton's peddling. That's what they think. One of the things that has consistently held libertarianism thus back is name recognition. A lot of people don't know what it means. A lot of people, they've heard libertarian, they don't realize there's an actual libertarian party. A lot of people still think libertarianism means, you know, Republicans that happen to take up that label. They think Rand Paul's the libertarian candidate. He's not. He's a paleocon, kind of, like Ron Paul. Ron Paul used the term libertarianism. At the end of the day, he's a paleoconservative. It's a lot closer. It's a hell of a lot better than neoconservatism, but it's not really libertarianism. It's more states' rights and get things back to the local and state level, as opposed to federal authority, I would argue. Of course, a state that's being tyrannical, it's just as bad as the federal government being tyrannical. That's the element of real libertarian party rhetoric, as you will, as opposed to those that take up the term and happen to be part of the Republican Party or something like that. Another person is Gary Johnson. Gary Johnson, the last time, in 2012, a lot of people realized Romney and Obama, I realized this too, were basically peddling the same bullshit. And the Libertarian Party managed to knock up a couple million votes, far more than it had in past elections. It was sort of a non-issue for most people in the country until 2008, when name recognition took off, in 2012, when people finally, I think, realized, and they realize now, the two parties are not that dissimilar. They're realizing it even more now. Specifically, Donald Trump is the best thing to happen to the Libertarian Party since Ron Paul became Doom Paul the meme. What Donald Trump has shown people is that the RNC and the DNC, that's those that actually control the parties and conspicuously fund every candidate, run all the PACs and so forth, are more concerned, the RNC is more concerned with beating up its own front runner than it is actually winning against the Democrats, to the point where there are people within the Republican Party unironically stating that they would rather lose with Ted Cruz than win the election with Donald Trump. There are people now currently unironically stating that, and they're not, you know, fence sitters. They're not like right-leaning independents who aren't that partisan. They're like, well, you know, I just can't get my head around this Trump dude. So, you know, fuck it, whatever, we'll let Hillary win, things will get worse, then we'll win. You spend years talking about how the Democratic Party is nothing but a socialist front of horrible pinko communists that hate everything about the country, and you're actually willing to allow them to govern for four more years. That's when the two-party dichotomy begins to break down in people's minds. People have realized that the donor class funds both sides. Hillary Clinton and Ted Cruz get funding from the same people. Now, here's Hillary saying we need, generally secularity and women protected, gays protected, gay marriage is non-negotiable, we should crack down on these guns, religions, you know, I believe in God, but religion's not that important to me, and this and that and the other thing. And by the way, taxes need to go up. Here's Ted Cruz saying, Jesus this, Jesus that, you know, sodomite marriage is not real marriage, and all these things, that taxes should be lower, and we're never going to have more gun control, I'll repeal it fucking all. And people realize that these two people, whose ideologies, the things that they say and supposedly believe, are completely diametrically opposed on most of these issues, are getting funded by the same people, like Goldman Sachs. Well, you know, Heidi Cruz was a chair at Goldman Sachs until fairly recently. Hillary Clinton has gotten money from Ted Cruz himself has gotten money from them. People have noticed this. Donald Trump's insertion to the campaign has all but destroyed all of the establishment Republicans that were running, until the only guy they can turn to now is a Tea Partier. He's not part of the centrist core of the ideology of the party. That's the one thing I will admit about Cruz that some people that feel more positively towards Trump don't see. He's an insider, yes. He's taking the same donor money as any, you know, the John McCain's or the Mitt Romney's, but his ideology is further to the right, or at least he brands it as being further to the right. He's not being dishonest when he says that. He is when he says, well, I'm outside of the establishment, we're gonna, you know, cut their fucking heads off and their fucking balls off. No, he's not, because he's taking their money. But his ideology, on a moral level at least, is more fringe, more authoritarian, oddly enough. Donald Trump has managed to rip this scheme apart and show people that basically the two parties are run by the same fucking people. They're making money off these elections, and so the natural result is people who don't really like Donald Trump's rhetoric, and they sure as hell don't like Hillary, they're flocking to third parties. My advice to them is, in the general election, no, you absolutely shouldn't stay home. Support the Libertarian Party. Democrats will find many redeeming qualities within its social message. Republicans will love its fiscal message. Why wouldn't you? It's the best of both worlds. I had thought for many years, even back when I was a partisan, I didn't have a problem with things like abortion and gay marriage. Even when I was like a Christian, I didn't really have a problem with these things. So I said, well, I'm a Republican, but at the same time, I keep hearing these Republicans rant about these as if they're the only fucking thing that matters. Are they morons? It just doesn't make sense to me. How can they say, well, small government this, small government that, but by the way, the government's going to be in your bedroom and your womb? It doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And then I was a Democrat for a while. You know, Bush was a disaster. George W. He ripped this country apart, he ripped the Constitution apart, he ripped the economy apart, he was an international embarrassment in every fucking possible way. That was George W. Thanks a lot, Bush family. I'm glad that you're backing Ted Cruz's campaign, by the way. Jeb just endorsed him. And Alan Bush, or whatever the hell his name is, he's one of his advisors. So yeah, he's obviously, and he was an advisor for George W. anyway, long ago when W. was in there. So then I said, well, the Republican Party, they've completely left common sense behind. Why should I support them? I'm going to vote for fucking Obama. I said, well, I'm a Democrat. I'm a liberal now because fuck the Republican Party. Only then Obama kept doing the same things that George W. had done. And I was like, well, what the fuck is the point of this? So then I kind of sat on the fence, but then I realized Ron Paul was actually sort of talking about the stuff that I wanted. So I primaried for him, and I voted in the general. I voted for Ron Paul. The fact that Mitt Romney had become the nominee, and people kept telling me, oh, don't waste your vote, you gotta get out and vote for Mitt Romney, because otherwise this evil communist Obama will win. I didn't care whether Obama or Romney won. They were the same fucking thing. I voted for somebody who made more sense. I mean, yeah, he had dropped out, he was no longer there, but, you know, write in Ron Paul. At least you show that you have some fucking common sense. Even he wasn't perfect, by the way. I don't like him ranting about the gold standard because I understand economic issues and that it wouldn't work. But his talks about states' rights in general, I agree with to a great extent. I'd like to return rights first and foremost to the individual, rather than to municipalities, cities, and states. But it's better than federal authority, certainly. We've seen that with education. Yeah, thanks. No Child Left and Common Crud have been disasters as well. You get two successive, supposedly, again, diametrically opposed administrations from two parties, basically proposing the same sort of federalized bullshit for our educational system and dumbing it down completely. Before Bush took over, we were doing fairly well. Now, by the end of Bush and Obama, we're basically dead last in the civilized world. We're starting to slide down to third world levels, or second world levels, as you may term it. You know, sort of the commie block nations in terms of our educational attainment. It's a real fucking problem. So then I said, well, Obama's left me behind. I voted for Ron Paul. But then the Republican Party treated him so badly. I said, well, there must be something better. Libertarianism, yay. Well, now I've joined the libertarian movement. I joined that because I realized that what I wanted all along was I wanted government out of my wallet. I don't agree with big government and abusive government on people's wallets. So, you know, I can't vote for the Democrats because they just want to tax everyone to hell and regulate everything. And I can't vote for the Republicans because I can't support people being socially abused either by big government. Both the parties want bigger government, they just disagree on where to apply it. And I should say this, I said this before, I can't remember in which video, but I'll say it again because it's very important for people to know. A lot of people make the mistake of saying, the Democrats want to give you your social freedom back and take your fiscal freedom. The Republicans want to give you your fiscal freedom back and take your social freedom away. That is completely wrong on two counts. The first count, the government doesn't give you freedom. You have freedom and the government just trods all over it at a whim because people don't understand the proper function of the Constitution. The second thing is this. The Democrats don't want to give you any real social freedom back. The Republicans don't want to give you any real fiscal freedom back. They just want to maintain the status quo in those respective areas and take more of your freedom in the other. So thereby, by successive administrations, things steadily get worse and worse on both ends. It's the natural course of things when you have two authoritarian, statist, ideologically dogmatic parties that don't really know what they're doing or know what they're doing and are completely corrupt. The Libertarian Party wants to reform both areas so that you don't have overt government overreach in the social sphere. You don't have a whole bunch of wasteful spending in the fiscal sphere. One problem we have right now is not even the presence of regulations, but because of the way it's applied, it screws small and regional businesses and it leaves corporations untouched, forming monopolies. And the Democrats don't even seem to realize that the same corporations that the partisan Democratic politicians will tell the little people within the Democratic Party, yeah, those evil corporations, wink, wink. Meanwhile, they're helping those businesses form monopolies by making sure that they're able to shield themselves from their tax laws. Because they can hire the accountants, they can hire the lawyers, they can hire the team of lobbyists to make sure they've got a senator in their pocket for when it comes tax time. Small business can't do that. And they get the added bonus of when that small business goes under, they get less competition. They keep blaming the right wing fiscally for that. It's not the right wing's fault because the right wing has tried to prevent more regulations from going forward, to prevent specifically this problem. The left wing has actually caused the corporate monopolistic system. And it was FDR, by the way, the patron saint of the modern Democratic Party, apparently, for some reason. It was FDR that spawned the military-industrial complex that made this possible. He was also the only president that actually was like Hitler in the sense of throwing people into concentration camps on the basis of their ethnicity. Something that the left often forgets. I don't know if they quite understand the history of the person that they use sort of as their mascot. Any more of the Republicans using Abe Lincoln, it's like, Abe Lincoln, I don't think in many ways would really be comfortable with some of your social views. So I'm a libertarian. I'm glad libertarianism is rising. The former story about a month ago was registrations for the Libertarian Party were skyrocketing, up something like 56%, I think, in not that long a period of time. That was good. The new news is that if the people that are expected to win their respective races for the nomination win, you could see the Libertarian Party break through the threshold not only to be considered a major party and thus be on all ballots, but also break through to that special 15, I believe, percent to be in the debates. If that happens, you're going to see within a couple of election cycles, libertarianism become the dominant U.S. party. Because people have started to leave the Republican and Democratic parties behind, and I don't see them really reforming themselves. Trump will try. At the end of the day, though, he may fail because he's going to be opposed by literally about 99% of the people within the RNC. How much can he alone get accomplished since he's not going to have the consent of Congress? If he does anything wrong, they'll probably move to impeach him. They'll try to get rid of him any way possible. If somebody like Hillary wins, it disenfranchises a good third of the Democratic Party, or maybe 40%, that back a self-proclaimed socialist. Well, you know, that's not going to help strengthen the partisan field of your party. What's happening is that people are abandoning two corporations, which is all that these two parties are, just a couple of corporations anyway at this point. They're money-making endeavors. They take money from donors, and they pass legislation in accordance with the money that they've gotten. That's all that they are. That's why they ideologically agree while claiming to ideologically disagree. That's why libertarianism is rising swiftly. Another thing is, again, as I said, social media. The message of libertarianism before was limited to you happen to know somebody who's receiving a libertarian newsletter or magazine or something. It didn't spread around very ably. Or there happened to be, you know, a shortwave radio station in your area. Some ham enthusiast has a libertarian broadcast that they do once a week or something. Now, of course, it's all over the internet. People are realizing it's the best possible ideology. It's the closest to our founding goals. The founders never envisioned a country in which we would bicker over who can screw who in bed, or who can do what with their bodies, or what the government should and should not do with money that's not, doesn't even belong to the government to begin with. We never would have had these debates at all if we had kept to those original feelings of our founders, their original sentiment. The system can work. It worked for the first roughly 50 years or so of our history, before, well, closer to 60 years, really, before you get the rudiments of industrialization. Then, of course, you get the cotton gin later on, and then everything's history. You start your steady march towards the Gilded Age. This supposedly would make everybody wealthy, and it didn't. It made them less wealthy. People could actually get ahead until then, and it isn't then for about 20 years until the Homestead Act that you have progress happening again in building what you would consider the rudiments of a literate middle class in this country. You know, you get this steady march towards industrialization. Really, all it did was spark a civil war because the South was too fucking lazy to want to hire white workers to pick their cotton and put it through a gin. They'd rather have slaves do it. You know, economically speaking, it wasn't feasible long term anyway, so what's the fucking point? Nobody from the South, none of the people that like sort of the Confederate flag culture, I don't care if you fly the Confederate flag, but I often get shit on for pointing this out, that the system that was in use by the South wouldn't have actually worked long term. Maybe for another decade or two, they would have become a third world backwater. All progress would have been stripped away. All those gleaming sort of white plantation homes would soon be shells of their former selves, or you'd have a slave revolt or something. Nobody wants to listen to me on that token, though, including a lot of people on the alt-right. I get shit on by them. I'm not really on the alt-right. I have generally positive feelings towards many of the things the alt-right says with regards to political correctness, but I'm a libertarian. I'm not on... People keep confusing me with a Trump supporter. I'm a Gary Johnson fan. I'm ecstatic that he's apparently polling in the double digits against a Hillary Trump matchup. By the way, in such a situation, Trump's still gonna win. Trump will win the presidency, I predict. But the rise of a third party is necessary anyway. The Republican Party is still dying down. The Democratic Party is still dying down. They've got to be replaced by something. It might as well be something that scales back abusive government. All the problems that people perceive of in this country, whether they're Democrats or Republicans, are caused fundamentally by government. Every war we've ever been in has been courtesy of the government. Every abuse of the population, it doesn't matter whether it was caused by a Democratic or a Republican administration, it was still the government that did it. Strip it of its power to a large extent, and it's no longer capable of abusing you. As for our own safety, do you really feel safer now than you did 10 years ago? While the government keeps getting bigger and they keep getting better weapons, you're never going to feel safer. You're never going to get any additional safety. You might as well not bother trying. The best thing we can do is have a highly armed population, and then man our nuclear weapons, and then let happen what happens. At least our enemy, if they're dumb enough to attack us, we'll get destroyed as well, completely from off the face of the earth in one last catastrophe. It was the government, by the way, as well, that let the cat out of the box in that too, with the atomic struggle that started the second Trinity exploded. Governments did that. You know, some little person, you know, walking down the street somewhere had nothing to do with it. They didn't even know it was happening. Unaccountable, secretive, abusive government is responsible for virtually all ills that all people around the world have experienced. There's burgeoning libertarian movements in other countries now, too. The entire world should adopt it. We would never have to worry about an atomic war. We wouldn't have to worry about government corruption. Governments would be too weak to be very corrupt. You know, if some government official steals $10 out of a soda machine, who fucking cares? But they're not doing that. They're stealing $10 billion out of the treasury from time to time. It's unacceptable. That's why I'm a libertarian. I'm probably going to stay a libertarian unless there's something better that comes along. And so far, studied a lot of political ideologies. I'm just not seeing it. I'm not taking in by alt-right stuff. You know, you're okay with me, but I'm a libertarian. I can't really go down that route. And I'm an American nationalist. I'm not a racial nationalist. I see American identity first and foremost as what drives my very being. And in support of my country, I choose libertarianism because I think it'll make my country stronger, it'll make it more stable, it'll make it safer, and it'll make it a hell of a lot more free and prosperous. Why wouldn't I support this ideology? I don't really care about anything else when it comes down to it. That's about all. Peace out.